Exploring and Addressing Diverse Inequalities. This is Angela Babb.
Hi, I'm Angela from ATD 4Fold. And this is us. What do I think when I hear the phrases inequalities? I think about not having enough food to eat. And I think about not having enough food because there is no job. Having no job means you can't make ends meet because there is not enough money to live on. It means getting by and living day to day. In other words, the phrase inequalities makes me think about system. Children and their families get trapped in poverty. And that's the fault of the system. Why do I blame the system? Many people like to say, we are dependent on benefits because they make life easy. But that's not true. We are not dependent on benefits. We are trapped on benefits and trapped in the system. I want to work but left school without the qualifications I need. Who will employ me without qualifications? I try to change this. I have done courses at a local community centre to try and get qualifications so that I can get work. So to try equal access to jobs. What people need is more support to make that next step. But even before looking for a job, why do some young people leave school without qualifications? Going to school is important. Kids need to get a good education because it will help them find a job when they are older. If they can't find a job, then they can earn money, pay their own bills and become independent. But not all children have equality chances of succeeding in school. In London, for example, students are supposed to have zip cards to pay for their transportation to school, but 2.5 years ago, my daughters had no zip cards. This meant that they could be thrown off the bus. That made them late for school. And sometimes it made them miss school altogether. The school complained about their poor attendance. It's fair to say that this was disrupting their education. They were missing out. And when you're late, I think the whole class gets disrupted. I don't remember the school ever asking if they could help. I realised that we needed a plan to get their zip card sorted out, but it was not easy. Firstly, you have to apply online, but I had no computer at home and no way to get online. I had to ask for help. Second, you also need an email address to apply for zip cards, but I didn't have one because I don't have a computer. So we had to create an email account for me. Thirdly, to apply for a zip card, I needed the girl's birth certificate and passport size photos too. We had lost the birth certificates a long time ago, so we had to order them replaced, and that cost money. We didn't have any passport size photos, so we had to buy them as well. So please do not tell me that education is free, just to finally get my daughter the zip card they needed to travel to school. I had to spend a lot of money at a time when we had trouble paying the rent on our flat. That's an example of one kind of inequality. Unequal access to a resource that is supposed to be for everyone. Another example of inequality is about blame. When you live in poverty, you always get blamed for your situation and told it is your fault that your children are growing up in poverty. When society says that child poverty is caused by bad parents, I feel society is trying to blame me for my situation. The system traps us and then blames us for being trapped, but society should be supporting us instead. It's all my fault that I left school without the qualification I needed, or is it some of the fault of the system too? When the failings of the system are blamed on parents, all that goes is undermine the family unit. The support that families get is unequal too. You can see your child struggling year after year, but not actually receive the diagnosis of autism until he turns 17. And if you are struggling to help your child sometimes, the only response from social services is to remove the child from your care. Custody is that happens. It might be many years before you can see your own children again. and before they're allowed to see their brother and sisters. By then, there's been so much strain and stress that you have to get to know them all over again. A good parent can live in poverty and offer their child all the love they can give. A bad parent can have all the money in the world and never give their child the attention they need. I live in poverty, but I still fight for my kids and for what they need. My children have seen me struggle, and I want a better future for them more than anything. I want them to have a good education and to be able to go to college or university. I want them to be happy in anything they choose to do. I want them to make the most of the opportunities that I never had. My mum was born in Venezuela but moved to London as a little girl. She worked in a school as a dinner lady who cooked and served meals. She also worked in the city cleaning office buildings. We mums have to be strong for our kids. We always focus on our kids. We put ourselves last. We're not strong for them. How can they ever overcome inequality?
Altogether in Dignity, ATD Fourth World. Thinking about all the diverse inequalities that are out there calls to mind the word intersectionality, which some of you may be very familiar with. Thinking about all the aspects of identity that are linked to oppression and discrimination, whether it's gender or race or ethnicity, religion, nationality, sexuality, disability, illness, and others. Last year, I was with a friend, Martine, and she and I were both invited to take part in a day-long conference on intersectionality. This was in Paris at the Paris 8 University. And Martine and I both spoke about the intersection between gender and the violence of extreme poverty. One of her points was that still today, there are feminist movements that remain mainly driven by concerns of middle-class women. And there's not always enough attention given to an issue here in Europe that women in poverty often cite as the very most vital, which is the patriarchy of social services. In Western Europe, social services can have a real stranglehold on, as Angela was saying, custody of children, many, many aspects to do with the household. And this, you know, the women's movements in Europe, I don't hear them talking about this at all. Whereas when you're meeting with women in extreme poverty in Europe, it's the number one issue, particularly in the United Kingdom, but elsewhere as well. During this event that I mentioned at Paris 8 University, there were a lot of people who appreciated the talk that Martine and I gave, but there was one participant who was very frustrated because she said, well, you didn't name the experience of black women in your talk. And if race isn't named, then black women are lost. She's not wrong. But Martine was very, very frustrated with this conversation because she's somebody who grew up in extreme poverty and who feels like that's also something that gets lost and is also not mentioned very often. When she was 18, Martine says, I'm gonna quote her, she says, I had ended up believing that I wasn't worth much, that I was a misfit, antisocial person, just dirt poor and nothing but poor. I never felt allowed to use words like intelligence and knowledge about myself. Now, although she said that, Martine has a very keen intelligence, and she spent the last 40 years of her adult life investing that intelligence on behalf of those she calls my people. Anyone, anywhere in the world who's has in common that feeling of growing up feeling like nobody expects anything of them, like they have no use in society. In the talk that we gave, Martine was talking about an action research project that she directed, showing that poverty is a form of violence. And she talked about a neighbor of hers who's insulted at every turn, who's told she's unworthy of raising her own children. A neighbor who was made to listen in silence to a room of social service staff who were listing every fault they thought she had. And when finally, although she was required not to say a word, she finally slammed a cup on the table in frustration. The social services had her led away by security officers, said she's violent, she should leave. That's an institutional violence that destroys lives. But Martine says the things that are done to us are never considered violence, because if we called it violence, that would disturb society. So the violence done to people in poverty stays invisible. But it's enough. Extreme poverty is violence, and society must not accept that any longer. People who grow up in poverty so often share that experience Martine has of not even considering herself worthy or smart. In the face of prejudice, they're told to keep quiet and listen. And when they attempt to break silence, they can be considered violent. I wanted to find a word that could encapsulate this. We talk about mansplaining when a man is speaking in a patronizing way to women, or white-splaining when white people are hijacking a conversation about racism. So what do we do when a person in poverty is being talked down to? Is that top-down splaining? I don't know. I think we need a word, because it happens. All social justice movements need for each person to be heard speaking about their own experience. And we all also need for a person who doesn't have personal experience of being marginalized to act as an ally. That word ally is a very important one in social justice movements. And even though we don't yet have a word for the silencing of people in poverty, we have defined the word ally. It's now in the Urban Dictionary as somebody who, for example, is not gay, but supports the rights of lesbian, gay, transsexual, and bisexual people. That was how it was first added to the Urban Dictionary in 2007. I think today it's really understood much more broadly for many marginalized groups to speak, for example, about men as allies in women's rights. But you know, having a very specific role, that's something that we have to sharpen. What is the role of an ally who is not themselves facing the form of oppression that they're talking about? I want to quote Francesca Ramsey. She's somebody on MTV with her show Decoded. She talks about overcoming racism and prejudice, and she defines the role of an ally as somebody who wants to fight for the equality of a marginalized group they're not part of. She says an ally's job is to support. You want to make sure you use your privilege and your voice to educate others, but make sure to do it in such a way that doesn't speak over the community members you're trying to support, and that doesn't take credit for things they're already saying. Speak up, but not over. Now I want to go back to 1970 in South Africa when people were fighting against apartheid. Steve Biko, who was an activist, a black activist, who was later tortured and murdered by the South African police, and he also spoke about their role of allies in the struggle against apartheid. He wrote, "The role of the white liberal in the black man's history in South Africa is a curious one. Very few black organizations were not under white direction. True to their image, the white liberals always knew what was good for blacks and told them so. That bunch of do-gooders goes under all sorts of names, liberals, leftists, etc. These are the people who argue that they're not the ones responsible for white racism. All true liberals should realize the place for their fight for justice is within their own white society. The liberal must apply himself with absolute dedication to the idea of educating his white brothers that the country of the history may have to be rewritten so that we may live in a country where color will not serve to put a man in a box." In hearing Francesca Ramsey and also Steve Biko talk about what it means to be an ally, I want to also mention Joseph Brzezinski. He's the person who founded ATD Fourth World that we're part of. And he's somebody who was born into extreme poverty. He also called for an alliance. He said a new alliance between established members of society and people in poverty. To be faithful to this alliance, we'll follow through completely our challenge to any of society's projects that exclude people who are the weakest. We want to impose in any field the participation of the most disadvantaged people and to denounce anything that puts a person in a situation of inferiority and leads to his rejection by others. We want to call for a project for the whole of society in the name of defending the most underprivileged people and the respect of their rights. Allies of people in poverty have an important role to play in challenging their own colleagues, their neighbors, or their relatives, but it's crucial they also make room for others to hear the voices of people in poverty directly, without silencing or interpreting people's words. After that day at Paris State University, Martine said to me, when that woman was shouting at us, I kept thinking of my people. That kind of attitude can divide us. and it can help politicians who want to pit us against each other. It breaks up solidarity. I then spoke about this day with Martine to another person who is an ally of ATD Fourth World. She lives in New York City, and her name is Rosa Cho. And she recalled a time when she felt like there were people protesting social injustice, but actually doing just what Martine said, pitting different causes against each other, saying who's the most victimized by this or that. So Rosa was very upset at the time. She said when she was able to take a little distance from her first emotions, then she realized my own subjectivity is ill-equipped to understand and feel the depth of the specific pains and sense of desperation, the hopelessness and not understoodness of the people who are arguing with me. I like that word, not understoodness, that Rosa created. All of us need solidarity very badly, because there's many forms of prejudice and systemic oppression that damage the whole of society. They short-circuit people's potential, they ignore all the contributions people can make. In order to strive towards solidarity between all those diverse inequalities, maybe each of us needs to explore more fully what it means for us to become an ally to whoever has a personal experience of oppression and prejudice and not understoodness that's different from our own. Thank you. So are there any questions?
Can I have that? Yes.
Thank you. I'd like to thank both of you.
Thank you.
Because I really appreciated both of your perspectives and the validity of both of your perspectives, so I'd like to thank you. Yeah. I've just been reading Nelson Mandela's book, because I'm going to South Africa soon, and the bit that stayed with me, and I keep reflecting on it, was the first time he went out to Botswana. He gets on an aeroplane and the pilot was black, and he went, oh, a black pilot, you can't have a black pilot, they're not qualified, you know? And then he realized that here he was, the leader of the military wing of the ANC, and he'd thought that, right? And he'd thought that because of the depth of his cultural upbringing, right? And I think we really need to address that, because it's so profound that anybody, if Nelson Mandela can have that thought about a black captain airline pilot, that's how profound it is, and that's how deep it is, and the addressing. So when you're talking about the relationship with the ally and not speaking over, it's actually really recognizing within yourself the depth of your, which is very unique, by the way. It's not just your, you can't say all British are like this or all Dutch are like that. It's very unique to you, your family, their ancestors, and everything else that makes you. Yeah, so I just wanted to add that comment. And I also wanted to say something, because there's a particular group of 12 million plus people across Europe who are Roma, who are not perceived as, because they're not one community, they're many, many communities, but they're a very silent, excluded group. I now live in Međimurje, which is the county in Croatia where two-thirds of the Roma in Croatia live. I live in a village with a Roma community. And it's, I just want to put it on record, because the importance of this particular many communities that overall are called Roma, who do within, if we look at the broadest definition of poverty, which goes beyond, it's what you were talking about, goes much beyond money, it goes into poverty of opportunity, poverty, you know, the depth of that, that here in Europe, that's a particular community that is very ignored.
Thank you very much. any other comments? Or
I just had a little question, and it's really technical, actually. You were speaking at the beginning about issues you were having with zip codes. What is that exactly? I didn't get it all.
So basically, in London, we have
for my children to get to school, rather than
basically we have oysters. So you basically you put money on the oyster, but the
oyster is a travel card.
Yeah, it's a travel card. So the zip card basically is free, but obviously it's free. Well, it is free in a sense, but when you're traveling on the train, you've got to put £1 because obviously it doesn't exceed. So basically that's what it is. So
it's
so
a travel card.
Yeah,
it's
a travel card for children.
School.
Yeah,
for so children are entitled to it.
Yeah, they're
free travel card.
They're entitled to free travel. Yeah.
You can't get it if you haven't got this and you haven't got that.
Yeah,
you
if you haven't
got it, the other.
If you haven't got, and obviously my kids have lost this, so we had to go through the process of getting an email, and now obviously you got to do it online, because before I used to do it at my local post office, and I found out, oh, you got to do it online, you got to have this, you got to have, and plus my daughter's birth certificate, I got lost as well, so I had to go to Islington. Mm. I had to go to Islington because she was born. They were born in Whittington. Go to Islington, get the birth certificate, they come back, and unfortunately, someone called Andy from ATD44. He helped me do it online because I was unable to use the computer to do it online myself.
Mm. I thought it was a very beautiful example of poverty and opportunity.
Mm. The online requirements are getting so much worse. There's a journalist named Stephen Armstrong who just published a book called The New Poverty. It's all about the UK. And in one of the chapters, he describes somebody who's a job seeker, who wants to apply for the job seeker's allowance. Well, to receive that allowance, you have to show that you've applied for, I think, 35 jobs every week, and you have to apply through a website that connects to the job seeker's allowance. So in order to do those job applications, if you don't have a computer, and if you're going to use the computer at the public library, first of all, he was looking at somebody who needs to pay to take the bus to get to the public library, because the free zip cards are only for school children, and adults has to pay. And then at the public library, there's a two-hour time limit. You know, even if you get there early and reserve, which you have to do because they're very in demand, your session will terminate automatically after 2 hours. And the clincher, when your two-hour session terminates, you're in the middle of a job application, the job seeker's website will not save it. You know, maybe you've put 40 minutes into this particular application because it can take that long for one, and it's all lost. And so the man who was following this chapter, he could not, make the 35 job applications, literally trying every single minute that he had free for, he couldn't, and therefore he had to pay a fine. It's like being charged for not having internet access. There's this whole social service network that thinks things are facilitated by the internet, but it ends up being very punitive.
Yeah, it's really ridiculous because it can be easily resolved and concretely.
You would think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so specific, so I guess it would be easy to have a team of intent to.
But it's like a war on people who are poor.
Yeah.
You word the word system. It's systematically
mm-hmm.
yes.
a war against those who are poor.
And it goes with the austerity agenda.
Yeah.
Because in the UK, the government has a very clear disinformation campaign to demonstrate that people in poverty do not deserve to receive any kind of benefits. It's a campaign that was run under several different governments, left and right, because it started in 2002. But in 2009, it got amped up with these horrible graphics, posters all over London that would show somebody who looked stereotypically poor, sometimes with a gun target superimposed over the person, and the big line, benefit thieves everywhere. You should call up and denounce, but
yeah,
I swear to you, I can show
you
the photographs.
I remember them.
Yes, and so even when those posters were no longer plastered around London, they remained on the government's website for several years with a notice saying, download these, print them out, put them all over your community. At the same time, the government admitted in its own reports that actual benefit fraud was something like 0.07%. So this massive campaign to get people thinking about benefit fraud was actually designed to get people to think we need austerity, we shouldn't be giving benefits to these people who must be thieves. And the posters that say, you know, stamp out benefit theft, invite the general public to call up and denounce anyone that they might have a grudge against, you know, whether or not they're actually committing any kind of fraud. And if an accusation like that is made, well, what happens? Sure, there's an investigation, but immediately the benefits stop. And if the benefits are stopped, well, then the children must be taken into care because there's no benefits to raise them. And then an investigation begins, but the damage is done. It's very, very insidious. Oh. And so that topic leads us back to another accomplishment of Angela's, because together with a whole bunch of people in the UK, this is before I moved to the UK, you all put together this amazing exhibition called The Roles We Play. And it's an interactive exhibition, it's also a book that shows faces and stories of actual people in poverty and the very hidden positive roles that they play in their community. You know, somebody who sees that there's a fight between teenagers and who doesn't hesitate to go out and calm everybody down and break it up, well, that person is a diplomat. And they're not recognized as a diplomat, but, you know, they're aware. So in the book, it gives each person the title peace activist or ambassador or, you know, whichever title a person really deserves for the roles that they play in their community that aren't seen when, you know, we're just looking at tabloids that talk about scroungers and skivers, and there's television shows like Benefit Street that really purport to show that everybody is a thief. When Benefit Street first went on the air, on the comments in social media, there were people who had watched it and who would say, this makes me so angry, they're wasting our tax money. The one person wrote, I want to walk up and down that street with a baseball bat bashing people. You know, it's fostering hatred.
Yeah.
And this just happens, you know, this atmosphere of hatred.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just give a very negative image of people who are struggling, actually.
Yes.
Yeah.
An image of people, and then also for each person themselves, you know, for children. How do they see their parents? It's one of the co-authors of The Roles We Play said she gave the book to her doctor, and her doctor read it, and then he said to her, you know, I realize I do have some patients who are on benefits, and I know that they're perfectly nice people, but I never connected it before with all the things that I hear on the news about, yeah, they're all benefit thieves and so on. I never made that connection before. And then he did, and he said, I want another copy of that book, I'm going to give my brother. It, you know, it's really important work to just get out there changing stereotypes, and it takes a lot of allies, like that doctor, to become an ally and say, I can change what my brother thinks.
It's culturally soaked in. I mean, for example, if you're going to become a doctor, you have to have the most highest grades at A level.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to come from a nice middle class family that, you know, just because you ain't going to get in.
Mm-hmm.
You know. So their culture, and also they have really tough training, doctors.
Mm-hmm.
And they have this ridiculous 5 years followed by another
mm-hmm.
5 years, but they don't actually know.
Mm.
They, and I'm not knocking them, because actually it's really tough, the training, but their awareness, as somebody who worked at a university with doctors and trainee
mm-hmm.
doctors for many years, their lack of awareness of the reality was very profound.
It can happen in a lot of professions. I have a friend who is a teacher, and her mother and her grandmother were teachers too, and she says, when my grandmother became a teacher, it wasn't that competitive. And, you know, you as a person might have failed courses in school sometimes and still become a teacher. And she said, that's not the case anymore. You have to have had top grades your whole life, which means you get into a classroom and not a single teacher understands what it's like to be the kid in the back of the room who's dreading every day and who feels behind. And if the teacher never has that experience, it can make it a lot harder to connect.
Yeah, it's really then about creativity and empathy. And go with the information you have and the experience you have about that,
mm-hmm.
to go a bit against the stream, or trying to dissipate that
mm-hmm.
kind of hate wave. And
yeah.
And the depths of your cultural upbringing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's tough work, but it's very nice that you do that. It must be hard.
Well,
but also, I mean, you probably get a lot from it.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's incredibly rewarding because it, you know, society is missing the contribution of so many people who have such an enormous potential. So it's extremely rewarding. Everything we do with ATD Fourth World, I think it's very, very positive. And, you know, it's something that absolutely everybody can be involved in, because we need allies. So perhaps a good view to end on.
Yeah.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you very much. I'm really glad you did that. That was good. Small audience, but
yeah.